You've got your grandfather's nose.
I had two daughters, Flo and Mabel. This is just wonderful.
Your mother's smile.
I feel like Miss Marple. All this information and it's mine.
And your grandma's strength of character.
Strong is, that's definitely a word you could use. Frightening might be another.
But what about the rest of you? Who do you think you are tomorrow at 9 on BBC Two?
One thing I love about Asian cinema is its breathtaking originality. Oh, and its uncompromising rawness. Oh, I suppose that's two things. Its unique visual style and its brash confidence. Well, I suppose that's four things I love about Asian cinema. Its hard-hitting action, the emotional depth, the sumptuous style, the iconic stars. Oh, you know, there are just too many things for me to mention. So join me, Jonathan Ross, for a journey into the world of Asian cinema.
Jonathan Ross's Asian Invasion, tonight at 10 on BBC Four.
Make things better the easy way with BBC iOne. Just press red before your usual CFAX numbers. It's available anytime and it's free.
It's enough to make a grown man cry. Jeremy Paxman finds his roots in the new series of Who Do You Think You Are? Tomorrow at 9. Now on BBC Two, from aristocratic country estates to inner city housing estates. Whose Britain is it anyway?
Britain is a nation of about 60 million acres and about 60 million people. The maths is easy. There should be about 1 acre, one of these, for each of us. But unfortunately, land ownership has more to do with history than maths.
Land isn't just a green and pleasant backdrop. For thousands of years, it's been bought, sold, fought over, and stolen. And it's that history that determines why we don't have that acre each today.
We're about to go on a journey round Britain, a country 60 million of us share, and most of us are passionate about. Our towns, our villages, our countryside, our land. But the question we rarely ask is who actually owns all this? In our travels, we'll meet British landowners, big and small. We'll find out who owns what and how they came by it. We're going to discover how the whole cake, 60 million acres in all, is shared out. Who owns the biggest and the smallest slices of Britain's land? The fact is that a tiny number of people own thousands of acres each, while the rest of us are living cheek by jowl. What does it tell us about modern Britain that 90% of us live on less than 10% of the land? Well, my son Dan and I are going to have a crack at finding the answers.
As far back as the Doomsday Book, nearly 1,000 years ago, just about everything was owned by the Crown, the Church, and William the Conqueror's favourite aristocrats.
So whose Britain is it today?
We'll meet the old money, the aristocrats who've owned the land the longest.
They say that you could have walked from the East Coast to the West Coast on neither family land.
And the new dukes and duchesses, the celebrities playing at country squires.
The future of the countryside, there's no doubt, is to be the playground of the city.
The richest landowners in London, whose streets are paved with gold.
The land legacies of the feudal past. And the land disputes of the present.
We don't want it fenced in. We don't want it looking like Calvitz.
And the land that time forgot. The missing acres of the clergy can't account for.
We would really like to know where that is.
Let's start with the largest part of the population. Us, the ordinary homeowners. A century ago, 1 in 10 of us owned our own homes. Now it's up to 7 in 10.
But the fact is, those homes are built on around 8% of the land in Britain. That's us, nearly all of us in that very small slice of the country. Dan discovered that we're being promised more houses, but will we be getting any more space?
We're always being told that Britain's being buried under a sea of concrete and that we live in a small and overcrowded island choked with traffic jams. And living in a city like I do, it's often easy to believe that. But if you go up in a plane and look out the window, it seems that Britain is still a remarkably rural and green country.
That's because it is. Britain has less urban land than many other countries in Europe. Very little of the country is developed. Lack of land to build on is one of the reasons houses are so expensive. But there's widespread resistance to building in the countryside.
The countryside should, first of all, be for agriculture. Once you've developed it, once you put a house or a road on it, it never goes back. And so you are encroaching and taking away from a very, very valuable resource.
Any development in rural areas is carefully restricted by stringent planning laws drawn up in 1947.
They froze the pattern of the countryside, and the squeeze of that has tightened over the years, so that the houses that are built are getting smaller and smaller.
Putting more homes on a smaller space may sound like some cunning ploy by a developer, but it's the government which demands an average of 14 homes per acre to satisfy the growing need for housing. We're used to having neighbours, but today we're getting to know them even better. In just one generation, the plot size of an average family home has dropped by a third. These two homes are in Milton Keynes in Buckinghamshire. The three-bedroom detached house on the right was bought by Hilary Redford and her husband Colin 20 years ago. They brought up their family here. Now their daughter Caroline Jay and her own family have moved into a newly built four-bedroom semi a couple of miles away. On the inside, the houses look similar. It's only when you venture outside the differences become apparent. The daughter's house has far less outdoor space.
We haven't got a front garden on our house, and we've got a pathway right in front of our house, so we do get people walking past. And I think that's the way the new houses are these days.
By contrast, her mother does have a front garden and private drive, and the back garden is more spacious.
I think it's better as it was when we moved in the 80s, because I still think you had more ground, more space in general between you and your neighbours. I think now they tend to build bigger houses for people, but they put too many houses on each plot now.
OK, so most of us live in a very small slice of Britain. That much we know. In fact, there's not much we don't know about the urban homeowner. For example, you could find out all about my house and what I paid for it from the land registry. But finding out who owns the other 55 million acres is no simple task.
Oh, give me land, lots of land, under starry skies above. Don't fence me in.
Considering that we're all pretty fascinated by who owns what and how much they paid for it, it is a bit surprising that in the last 1,000 years, there's only been 2 significant attempts to make that kind of information public. The first was the Domesday Book, compiled about 20 years after William the Conqueror invaded in 1066. The second was this, the Victorian version of the Domesday Book.
The Return of the Owners of Land, published in the early 1870s. Now, what these books did was cover nearly all the land in the whole of England, Ireland, Wales and Scotland, and it's pretty accurate.
The Return was the brainchild of Lord Derby, a big landowner who wanted to know how much of the country was owned by the aristocracy. So anyone with more than an acre was asked to record how much they owned and what it was worth. Let's look up some of the great landowners. What about the descendants of my favourite 19th century aristo, the Iron Duke, Duke of Wellington?
Webster. Ah, yes. Duke of Wellington, just after Mrs. Welford. Duke of Wellington, as in Stratfield say, has 15,847 acres, bringing in about 16,000 quid a year. Very nice.
What if I wanted to know how much land the present Duke of Wellington owns? The Land Registry was set up in 1862, and its job is to make sure all land in England and Wales is registered. Its lawyer is Mike Westcott Rudd.
Right, Mike. I think people are fascinated by knowing just who owns what. You know, my hero is the Duke of Wellington. We'd like to know just kind of what he owns now, so can we pull him up on your system?
Yeah, let's have a look. Okay. There's Stratfield Say House. None of our indexing on there, which means neither the house itself nor any of the surrounding detail you can see on the screen there, is registered. None of it's registered at all.
And why wouldn't that be registered?
If property's been handed down father to son, for example, there won't have been a registration trigger, so it won't have come to Land Registry.
So what's the trigger?
Trigger is if it's bought or sold or if it's mortgaged.
So at the moment, there's no way for people like us sitting here to find out what the big landowners actually own because they haven't registered it.
That's absolutely right. So there'll be a number of properties just like this that are still not registered.
How many properties in Britain don't we know who owns?
Well, it depends if you talk about properties or land. We've got a fairly good idea of how many properties there are, and there are about 24 million, and about 20 million of those are registered. If you're talking about land itself, then about 50% is registered, which means 50% is unregistered still.
So we don't know who owns literally half of England and Wales. Half. That's not because the owners don't know it's theirs. It's because they don't have to tell the rest of us.
In Scotland, almost all land is registered. But in England and Wales, the land of many old institutions, universities and even government agencies is not. Nor are some of the wealthiest landowners in the country, because they've handed their land from father to son for generations. It's surprising that we don't know who owns the land, because often we're paying for it. The current Duke of Wellington's Stratfield Say Farms, for example, get thousands of pounds in grants and subsidies. We wrote to the Duke, but he declined to reveal how much land he owns.
A lot of landowners have privileges the rest of us don't. And one of the privileges is extremely important. They don't pay any tax on their land, and they get subsidies from us, the taxpayers. If landowners are going to be paid subsidies, we have a right to know. The moral argument is very simple. We, as citizens, have to register what we own. If we have to, everybody has to.
But until everybody is registered, it'll be difficult to form a complete picture of who owns the country. So we spend a lot of time working it out.
It's the old money that's given us the most trouble. The people at the top who've owned the land the longest. As we've seen, there's no obligation on them to reveal what they own, so they rarely do. Luckily, there are one or two aristocrats who are not at all bashful about revealing what they own and how they came by it.
The Dukes of Northumberland have been major landowners for centuries, since the Percy family invaded with William the Conqueror and were rewarded with land. I met Ralph Percy, the 12th Duke of Northumberland, at his salmon stream. He owns 135,000 acres and Alnwick Castle. Visiting children now just play at being knights of the realm. But in the past, holding on to land was a brutal business, especially for a Catholic family. Few of the early Percys died in their beds.
Our fortunes went up and down like a yo-yo, and in the 16th century we actually virtually lost everything under the Protestant times of Henry VIII. Fortunately, when Mary, his daughter, came to the throne, we were granted our lands back, and this chap, the 7th Earl, came to the forefront, and things were going quite well until Elizabeth I came to the throne, and she being Protestant, she made life pretty difficult for him. He rebelled against her in the Rebellion of the Northern Isles and lost his head as a result.
Oh dear. What about the other one?
So, well, the next one was the 9th Earl, who, his cousin, was involved in the gunpowder plot. He was implicated and had to spend 15 or 16 years in the Tower.
Now, who of all these wonderful characters in here, who really set the family up and made the estate a fixture?
Well, I suppose there was a lot of luck involved, really. I mean, the male line ran out at the end of the 17th century, and the female line went through Elizabeth, who married Hugh Smithson, a Yorkshire baronet. He improved the agriculture, and then the Industrial Revolution came along, and everything went pretty well for the estate, really for the next 100 years or so.
At the height of their power, the Dukes of Northumberland owned 200,000 acres, as recorded in the Return of the Owners of Land, the Victorian Doomsday Book commissioned by Lord Derby.
Lord Derby knew a thing or two about land. He owned a 70,000-acre slice of it in Lancashire, and he was in no doubt about the benefits it bestowed on its owners. As well as the sheer sport and pleasure of it, he listed political power, economic power, and social status. But does land still have these benefits for the owners?
Oh, I think there's a lot of pleasure in it. I'm passionate about my fishing, so it's rather nice to be able to pop down whenever I want to and cast a fly. and I love the shooting and everything else that goes with the countryside, really.
As well as pleasure, land brought wealth and influence. The 7th Earl of Lonsdale's family owned 67,000 acres, centred round the Lowther estate in Cumbria. They exploited the land for farming and forestry, and above all for coal mining.
They really kicked off the Industrial Revolution in the north of England. I say that deliberately because Middlesbrough was largely built by them. Pontefract and Leeds. They say that you could have walked from the east coast to the west coast on Lowther family land.
The Lonsdale's symbol of success was Lowther Castle near Penrith.
Victorians were filthy rich. It was described them as being Arabs of their day. They spent money like water on big houses and more big houses and goodness knows what.
Lonsdale's ancestors also wielded great political power. Until the Reform Act of 1832, land gave peers in the House of Lords control over MPs with seats in their boroughs. But the British aristocracy's position came under threat in the 20th century with the introduction of punitive taxes. Super tax on income forced the Lonsdales to sell their coal towns and retreat to Lowther. But the house was lost too when the sporting 5th Earl, who gave his name to the Lonsdale boxing belt, refused to cut back his spending. He made a flamboyant exit.
He got into his motor car, Rolls-Royce, presumably, with his chauffeur and his valet and butler. And he said, if I can't live there in the style to which I'm accustomed, I will not live there at all. And that was the last time he ever saw Lowther.
The castle was closed in 1936 and is now a picturesque ruin. The aristocracy was also clobbered by inheritance tax, or death duties. At its highest, in 1956, it was at 75%. Among those affected were the Dukes of Rutland, who owned Beaver Castle in Lincolnshire.
This estate, up to about 1925, I think was about 125,000 acres. We're down to about 15,000 now. That's partly just due to, that's partly bad tax planning, that's partly all sorts of reasons. We haven't been totally successful.
The following were successful.
Economic power wasn't the only one of Lord Derby's landowning benefits to take a tumble in the 20th century. All but 92 hereditary peers were evicted from the House of Lords in 1999, and with them went the aristocracy's political power.
I got into House of Lords in about April, I think it was, and then, of course, I was kicked out in November, so I went about 11 times, I think, and I didn't have a chance to make my maiden speech, which I'm sad about, but there we go.
So the aristocracy went through tough times in the 20th century. But do they still enjoy a special position in society? Now, Lord Derby's other benefit for the big landowner was social influence. How about that nowadays?
I don't think there's a lot of social influence, really, nowadays.
But when you wander around the town, do people doff their caps to you?
No, I don't think so. I don't think many would recognise me.
Can I ask you a quick question? Would you recognise the Duke of Northumberland if you saw him in the street?
Aye. Drinks in the club.
Are you he?
Indeed I'm not. No, indeed I'm not.
Can't say too much about him. I'm a tenant.
Would you recognise the Duke of Northumberland if you saw him? Would you recognise the Duke of Northumberland if he walked down the street?
I recognise you, but not the Duke of Northumberland.
That's the best answer I've had. I bet 100 years ago, all those people would have recognised the Duke. Well, as we've seen, back then, aristocrats and landed gentry owned half the land. There's no doubt their slice has gone down a bit since then, but by how much? We'll revisit our friends in high places later on in the programme and have a stab at working out how much of the country they own today. But first, Dan examines whether the new aristocrats, the rich and fabulously famous, are taking over the old guard's green acres.
Once upon a time, all you needed to live in the Cotswolds was a red face, a bit of land, and a shotgun.
But this rural idyll is now becoming home to our new 21st century aristocracy. Not content with filling up our television screens and newspapers, celebrities are now to be found buying up the countryside.
House in the country and a big sports car. He's got a house in the country.
Everyone from Elton John to Stella McCartney has a country estate, with Madonna the acknowledged queen of the new county set. And the best place to play celebrity squires is undoubtedly the Cotswolds. Kate Moss, Kate Winslet, Liz Hurley, and even that one-time Hellraiser Damien Hirst have all been getting in their Range Rovers and buying country houses in this fashionable corner of England.
That is absolutely massive.
This is Toddington Manor, bought by Damien Hirst for £3 million. Damien's crumbling country pile came with 300 rooms and 124 acres of land.
I'll tell you what, those sheep better watch out. If they're not very careful, they might end up in the Tate Modern, chopped into bits and put in formaldehyde.
In the Cotswolds, I met up with Clive Aslett, the editor of Country Life, to find out why the area is attracting so many celebrities.
People often come when they've just had children and they want to bring their families up in a place which has got a better quality of life. I think that's a big driver. But the Cotswolds is a fashionable place as well. It's not very threatening country.
Is this a good thing for the countryside?
Well, it is, because there's an agricultural revolution happening at the moment. Agriculture is on the floor. It's not likely to get up again. And the people who are coming are bringing money which they've made in the city and they're spending it locally. They're stirring up some of these communities. The future of the countryside, there's no doubt, is to be the playground of the city. It's changing, and whether one likes it or not, it's unstoppable.
Celebrity property is spread around the country with different groups clustering together. Alderley Edge in Cheshire is famous for attracting footballers from Premier League clubs like Manchester United and Liverpool. But recently, the cash pouring into Chelsea FC means that the stockbroker belt surrounding Cobham in Surrey is giving Cheshire a run for its money. Former Chelsea and England international Graham Lasseau is just one of many top football stars who live around here.
Since Chelsea moved their training ground to this area, the manager, Jose Mourinho, has asked the players to live within a certain radius of the training ground.
Unlike the pseudo-toffs in the Cotswolds who have chosen to join the Green Welly Brigade, footballers tend to be more comfortable with the suburban security of the commuter belt.
If you can find a community with which you can relate to, then that helps you feel sort of more comfortable in the area. I think if you go further out, you're then starting to get into the realms of the countryside proper. Certainly the football players I know wouldn't feel comfortable living in that sort of isolation.
If the big stars at Chelsea don't want to buy lots of land, just how significant are the celebs and the footballers as landowners? It's something I asked Clive Aslett about in a swanky Cotswold bar.
Are the new rich buying up enormous slabs of countryside?
They're tending to buy, I don't know, 100 acres, something like that, so that they've got their own view protected, so they can have fun country pursuits and sometimes country sports, so their children can grow up there in the best possible surroundings. But that's nothing at all in relation to the great aristocratic estates, which might be tens of thousands of acres, or even to what people would regard as a productive farm, a farm which was actually going to keep going, which would probably have to be 1,000 acres these days. So 100 acres isn't that much, really.
However many green wellies they buy or riding lessons they take, it's clear that new money isn't about to drive old money off the land anytime soon. Frankly, all the newcomers seem to want is a nice big house with enough space to keep the paparazzi at bay. And they can afford to leave the hassle of owning serious amounts of land to someone else.
So they may account for acres of newsprint, but in terms of land, the celebrity rich really don't add up to a great deal. We're giving them a tiny, tiny slice of the cake.
But there is a group of new rich who really do own a sizeable chunk of Britain. Private individuals, businessmen like Harrods owner Mohammed Al Fayed, who has a large slice of Scotland, and even his own castle. They're buying great tracts of land for investment or for pleasure. Bully beef billionaire Edmund Vesti owns 100,000 acres. The newspaper barons, the Barclay brothers, even have their very own island in the English Channel.
Add the entrepreneurs with golf courses, stud farms and holiday centres and all that sort of stuff, and we estimate non-aristocratic private landowners account for 15% of land in the UK.
So far, between the homeowners, the celebs and the private landowners, we've only accounted for a quarter of the country. To find our next big landowner, I'm heading north of the border. Scotland is a country of 19 million acres. And well before Mohammed Al Fayed spotted it as a great place to buy a castle and a few thousand acres, the royal family had already moved in.
Here's an interesting fact. If Britain became a republic tomorrow, and the Queen lost all the palaces and castles and lands that go with the job of being monarch at the moment, Elizabeth Windsor would still be one of the top 20 private landowners in this country.
And as you would expect, these private lands are in some of the most beautiful parts of Britain.
Her Majesty owes her personal empire to the enterprise of her great-great-grandmother, Queen Victoria, and that formidable lady's love of the Highlands.
When Victoria came to the throne in 1837, she was not amused. Victoria was land poor, because her grandfather, George III, had handed the crown lands to Parliament. She and her cash-strapped husband got most of their income from the government. By comparison, the aristocracy's wealth still came from the land, and the biggest estates were here in Scotland, like the 500,000 acres owned by the Marquess of Breadalbane. In 1842, Victoria and Albert visited his home, Taymouth Castle.
When Victoria came here, she got the heartiest of Scottish welcomes. A band of pipers,
guards firing guns in the air. She describes it in her diary as one of the finest scenes imaginable.
Much of the castle's interior dates from the time of that royal visit, still preserved as it was over 150 years ago.
This leads us to the Banner Hall, which was one of the rooms that the Marquis used when the Queen came on her tour of accession.
Isn't this wonderful?
There was a ball special.
There was a special ball with Highlanders. they had a grand, that day they had a grand firework display. Yes. They had cannons firing on the hills round about. Yes. It was an enormous do.
And she sat at one end. There's a little picture, isn't there?
There's a picture of her sitting at one side and the Highlanders dancing.
It's extraordinary, isn't it? Well, imagine this young queen, newly married, mm-hmm. coming here, happy, first visit to Scotland, and she's surrounded by all this magnificence.
I think it was definitely the start of a love affair with Scotland, definitely.
Having fallen in love with the Highlands, the royal couple were bound to want a Scottish estate of their own, and within a few years they were renting Balmoral, an estate that came with 17,000 acres south of the River Dee. But renting wasn't good enough for the royals. They wanted to buy the estate outright.
Albert knew how to play the property market. He knew that once they moved in, they'd have the owner over a barrel. They could beat his price down, safe in the knowledge that no one would dare try and evict the Queen.
Albert managed to buy the estate at the knockdown price of £31,500. That's roughly £3 million in today's money. He had the existing castle demolished and put up a building he described as being like a private gentleman's house. But he wouldn't have long to enjoy his Highland retreat. Prince Albert died in 1861, and Balmoral became a place of pilgrimage for the royal family. Victoria would spend August to November ensconced in her dear Albert's creation. Balmoral wasn't Albert's only legacy. He also left her Osborne House on the Isle of Wight, which he'd bought in 1845. And after Albert died, Victoria went on to buy the Sandringham estate, complete with 8,000 acres of prime Norfolk farmland. By the end of Victoria's reign, the royal family had succeeded in becoming substantial private landowners.
Osborne House was given to the nation once Queen Victoria died, but the big estates, Sandringham and Balmoral, are still very much in private royal hands.
And under her descendants, they're still growing. Sandringham's now up to 20,000 acres, with tenant farms, stud farm and a country park. And Balmoral has tripled in size in the years since Victoria bought it.
And don't forget, they've had a bit of help from us. In the last 100 years, a lot of land belonging to the aristocracy was sold off to pay expensive death duties. Balmoral and Sandringham, though, were protected from all that, as the royal family managed to pay a little tax for much of the 20th century.
So the Queen is now up there with the most land-rich aristocracy. But her private land is just a fraction of what we're calling Crown land, most of which has been out of royal control for centuries. The Crown owns nearly all Britain's seabed, stretching 12 miles from shore, and a lot of valuable land and property, including Regent's Park in London. The Crown estate is worth £5 billion. But the profits go to the Treasury, not to the monarch. However, the Queen does get £10 million a year from the Duchy of Lancaster, land and property that have provided the monarch with an independent source of income since the reign of Henry IV. It's a legacy from feudal times.
The source of Prince Charles's personal wealth, the Duchy of Cornwall, also originates in a feudal legacy. Dan's discovered there's a lot more to the Duchy than just a brand of posh biscuits.
Maiden Castle in Dorset is Europe's largest Iron Age hill fort.
but this ancient monument is also part of a working farm, and as such, is a small outpost in a vast and unique property empire. Where I'm standing may be closer to London than Land's End, and yet this farm is actually part of the Duchy of Cornwall. That's an ancient estate that throughout the centuries has guaranteed an income to generations of Princes of Wales. The farm is run by John Hoskin, a tenant on over 1,200 acres of duchy land.
So this is all the prince's land, really. I mean, does he take much of an interest in the sort of day-to-day running of the farm?
He takes an interest in what we're doing on the farm. I wouldn't say day-to-day, but certainly what we're doing on the farm as a whole, yes, takes a great interest.
The prince visits this part of Dorset quite a lot. That's because John's farm is right next to one of his favourite pet projects, the newly built Dorchester suburb, Poundbury.
The new development at Poundbury, very much the hot topic at the moment. In this last few years, tremendous development taking place. And so we've seen sort of part of what was our farm and part was the fellow tenant's farm suddenly being taken completely over and being developed. And nobody likes, you know, being built on their doorstep, but it has to happen, and what has happened there has been done very tastefully.
And with the Prince of Wales setting the architectural style, it's a developer's dream. Poundbury is Prince Charles's homage to the traditional English village. There are no satellite dishes or yellow lines here. The windy streets give the impression of a town that's been here for centuries, rather than since 1993. Despite its rather retro architecture, Poundbury has got itself the reputation for being at the cutting edge of modern town planning. Even the Chinese have sent over a delegation to see how it's done. The best place to get a view of Poundbury is from the top of Maiden Castle itself.
It's only from up here on Maiden Castle that you get a true sense of the scale of Poundbury. What's impressive that the duchy has managed to do is change this green farmland into development property. In landowning terms, that's a bit like winning the lottery.
No planning permission difficulties here. In this area, farmland is worth £5,000 an acre. With permission for housing development, it can be worth up to £1 million. Charles himself isn't allowed to profit from the sale of duchy land. Instead, the Poundbury money is ploughed back into the estate, making the duchy an even more profitable inheritance. Charles came into this inheritance when he turned 21. Later, when he received his feudal dues, the duchy council dressed up in bearskin and presented him with 2 greyhounds, 100 silver shillings, and a 3-pronged salmon spear, whatever that is. Documents that chronicle the duchy's beginnings nearly 7 centuries ago are still to be found in the National Archives. In 1337, Edward III made his son, the Black Prince, the first Duke of Cornwall. And to ensure his son was a man of great power, he signed over a huge chunk of land, the Duchy of Cornwall.
These incredible documents are detailed accounts of the Black Prince's new property. They're a snapshot of the Duchy of Cornwall at the very moment of its birth, around 700 years ago. And what's particularly fascinating is that many of the place names that I'm reading here are still part of the duchy today.
Here's the island of Tintagel, and here's Fordington, that included the land around Maiden Castle. This is what the duchy currently looks like in the 21st century. More than 250 farms, orchards in Kent, woods in Herefordshire, and a third of Dartmoor. Oh, and the duchy owns the Scilly Isles. At 135,000 acres, it's the equivalent to half of Berkshire.
Prince of Wales has lots of titles. He's actually the Duke of Rothesay, the Earl of Carrick, and Baron Renfrew, and my favourite, Lord of the Isles. But it's only by being the Duke of Cornwall that he actually gets any income, gets any cash. And he does pretty well out of being Duke of Cornwall. He gets about £36,000 a day.
Charles doesn't get a penny from the civil list. His spending money is generated by land and property rented out by the duchy. to see where just a small fraction of this cash comes from, I've come down to Salcombe in Devon.
Now, Salcombe itself isn't built on duchy land, nor does the duchy own any of the pubs or shops in the town. What the duchy does own, however, is one particularly valuable asset.
Believe it or not, the duchy owns the bed of the estuary on which Salcombe is built. Their land may all be underwater, but it means it's entitled to a cut of the harbour dues and mooring costs paid by visiting boats.
Well, I must say, if you've got to own a lot of old mud on the bottom of a river, there are a lot worse places to own it than here. It's an absolute gold mine.
Salcombe Harbour gives the duchy £65,000 each year. That's from just one of the many rivers and estuaries it owns in the southwest. But not all the duchy's properties is to be found in picture postcard corners of England. Many of the duchy's more lucrative properties are to be found in Britain's cities. The duchy has owned the land under these office blocks since 1337. But you won't find this notably ugly building in the duchy's publicity brochures. It's only the name which gives away the Cornish connections.
Philip, can you tell me the importance of these two beautiful buildings here?
Well, these two beautiful buildings, some might call them carbuncles on the face of London, actually are part of the commercial property portfolio of the duchy. And the duchy's been moving into commercial property in quite a big way recently. Other office blocks, warehouses, stuff like that, and much less agricultural land.
It's thanks to the commercial property that the prince's income continues to grow. And while Charles himself pays income tax, the duchy is allowed to operate tax-free.
The duchy doesn't pay any capital gains tax. It can move its money from one area to another without having to worry about certain tax liabilities that other property companies would have to consider. And that's why the annual income of the duchy has increased so much.
But the duchy has told us that because the profits are reinvested in the business, there would be no tax to pay. The money they receive and the tax they pay has been argued over between the royals and Parliament for centuries.
Well, one thing's for sure. The estate that Edward III set up for his son is still doing precisely the job for which it was intended. Nearly 700 years later, the Duchy of Cornwall ensures that the current Prince of Wales is a man of great power, wealth, and influence.
Power, wealth, and influence are all very well, but even when you put all the royal acres together, the Crown's share of the nation's land is surprisingly small, just under 1%. So we're still left with quite a lot of the land to account for.
The Crown and the royal family's land and property are there for all to see, but there are no records for some of the other ancient landowning institutions. Oxford and Cambridge universities are prime examples. Now, we've worked out that the Oxford colleges have nearly 130,000 acres of very valuable land. The Cambridge colleges have a little less. They've been selling off land over the years. And they're not the only institutions to do so.
The big pension funds, banks and property companies are getting out of land and into urban property, where the profits are higher. But still, we estimate that commercial institutions in the UK account for 4% of the land. So, in they go.
So far, we've been trying to piece together who owns Britain. But knowing who owns what is not just a matter of principle. For the villagers of Peterston in South Wales, not knowing has had devastating consequences. They assume the local authority owned the land between their houses and the road until one New Year's Eve, a letter arrived asking for money to cross it.
We suddenly received a demand from a person we now know as the Lord Marcher of Trellick, as he calls himself, a certain Mark Roberts. And it alleged that he now owned the grass verges in front of the houses here, and in fact, some land in front of my house.
Mark Roberts is a local businessman who uses his knowledge of feudal history to pull an extraordinary 21st century stunt. He buys up old aristocratic titles that have small amounts of land attached. And because the land in Peterston wasn't registered, Roberts used the title of Lord of the Manor of Rumney, which he'd bought for £10,000, as proof of ownership. Barrister Simon Vollans is chairman of the Peterston campaign.
This is the copy of the map from the Land Registry that shows Broad Street Common, as it's expressed to belong to Mark Roberts. We're just stood around about here at the moment. A lot of the marks just show verge at the side of the road. It's not a very inspiring piece of land, but it's all he needs for ransom people for access.
One of the first villagers to pay up was Julie Foster.
In April 2001, we had our own letter. This solicitor was basically saying that we are trespassing and we can pay him an appropriate amount for compensation and costs. Part of you feels really upset and part of you feels really angry, and we really wanted to go to court. We really wanted to fight this on the grounds of principle. And in the end, we decided that we wouldn't. It was too much of a gamble. And we settled, and I can't actually say how much we settled for because it's a part of our agreement with him, but we did have to raise a second mortgage, so it was significant.
They were demanding at the time about 9% of the value of my house within 28 days. Otherwise, I was going to be taken to court.
After a lengthy campaign, the House of Lords reduced any future claim to 2%. Now the villagers are going to court to try to prove that Roberts doesn't own the land at all and to get his title taken off the land registry.
We have to try and get this land deregistered now, but the final irony is that if we are successful in getting the register rectified so that Roberts no longer owns it, it's Roberts that gets compensated for losing his registration, and the people in the village who have paid him money under a mistake get nothing.
It's remarkable how much arcane feudal law underpins 21st century land ownership. In fact, until 2 years ago, Scotland's landowning system was effectively feudal. Now, land reform by the Scottish Parliament has given crofters the right to buy the land they work from the old owner, whether he likes it or not. Also, local communities in Scotland get first refusal on buying estates that come up for sale. Nevertheless, it's a Scotsman, the Duke of Buccleuch, with a quarter of a million acres, who is the biggest landowner in the UK, if not the whole of Europe.
The estate's been in the Duke's family for hundreds of years, and he's spoken out against land reform.
Estates have been dismembered and fragmented, and therefore those who look after the land have been dispossessed, replaced by individual owner-occupiers who, with the best will in the world, simply haven't got the resources or the know-how to do what estates have been doing.
The Duke of Buccleuch said the Scottish land reforms were shameless, legalised theft. He's holding on to his acres in Dumfriesshire and managing them as he thinks best. The Duke may be the largest landowner in the UK, but he's certainly not the richest. To find out who that is, you have to go to London. Britain's capital is where the money is. Dan and I took a stroll across London's West End without leaving land belonging to just four wealthy families.
This is my starting point. A walk from Sloane Square to Mayfair crosses the two richest family estates in London, the Earl of Cadogan's and the Duke of Westminster's. Every step I take towards Dan is worth a small fortune.
The Manor of Chelsea was one of the London estates acquired by Henry VIII when he ransacked the monasteries. He left it to his wife, Catherine Parr, the one who survived. Later, it was bought by a court physician named Hans Sloane, whose daughter married into the Cadogan family.
This land is still owned by the Cadogans, whose family motto is, "He who envies is the lesser man."
Well, we may envy him, but for the current Earl of Cadogan, jealousy is scarcely a problem, because he's the second richest landowner in London. And he can walk all the way from Sloane Square, right down there, way up to Harvey Nichols in Knightsbridge, without stepping off his own pavement.
Now, Lord Cadogan is about the same age as I am, but that's where the similarity ends. He's worth getting on for £2 billion. Living in his manor isn't cheap. A house, like this one in Cadogan Place, would set you back £12 million. But for Lord Cadogan, the money is in commercial property, and Chelsea is home to some of the swankiest shops in London.
At the same time that Chelsea was being built, this area was springing up. Marylebone. Rich Londoners fled here after the Great Fire of 1666.
Marylebone is famous for its physicians. Doctors started moving into Harley Street in 1828, and today there are more than 1,000 on this one street alone. This is the Howard de Walden estate. It belongs to the three Howard de Walden sisters. These society ladies don't like to talk about money, but their London property is said to be worth £1.3 billion.
Just next door here is Viscount Portman's estate, 110 acres valued at around £1 billion. Now, Viscount Portman's ancestor was given this land by a very considerate Henry VIII because he needed some farmland to provide his poorly wife with goat's milk.
By the 18th century, it was an up-and-coming Georgian development, and now the area is once again back in fashion. Style guru Peter York lives in Montague Square, and as film stars and celebrities move in, he's very pleased with his address.
Should I bore you rigid about this house and this square?
Please
and
do.
This area? Well, I'll tell you, I know everything. No, almost. This is a pretty typical larger size speculator's house of 1813. These trees are preserved. Nobody is allowed to touch them. Every single tree is known and regulated by the Westminster Council arboriculturalist. Over there is our most famous neighbour down that street. I can't possibly identify it in a specific way, but is Madonna.
Just as they followed her out to the Cotswolds, a flock of celebrities has settled around Madonna's £5.5 million townhouse in the Portman estate.
At least two film stars, I'm told. They're both called Kate. So film stars called Kate live here.
That's got to be Blanchett and Winslet.
Of course, every landlord's dream is to have someone famous move into their territory. It doesn't half boost the value of your land. And when King George IV decided to make Buckingham House his main place of residence in 1826, the neighbouring five fields instantly became the place to live.
The fields had been the dowry of a 12-year-old girl called Mary Davis, whose father died of plague in 1665. Sir Thomas Grosvenor paid Mary's mother £5,000 for her hand in marriage and the five fields and the bog.
That bog is now Belgravia, the smartest address in London.
And it's the basis of the fortune of the richest landowner in the country, whose 300 acres in London is the world's most valuable real estate. Today, the 6th Duke of Westminster, Baron Grosvenor, Earl Grosvenor, Viscount Belgrave, Marquess of Westminster, Major General in the Territorial Army, owns £4 billion worth of London. His motto? One business approach, one culture, one shareholder. That's him. Until recently, if you bought a property from these four dynasties, you could only buy it leasehold. The families held onto the freehold. So when the lease runs out in 100 years or so, they get the property back.
The secret of all these estates is the dynasty principle, and it's paid off handsomely for these great names of central London. You don't think about yourself, you don't think about your own generation. You think about your children's children. You think very, very long term.
The dynasties have controlled the West End of London for centuries, and they hope to do so forever. But a change of the law in the 1990s has begun to undermine their legacy.
The new law gave buyers the right to buy the freehold of their house. For the Tory government, it was the dawn of home-owning democracy. But it was the beginning of the end for the great estates.
The Duke of Westminster resigned from the Conservative Party, resigned the whip in the House of Lords, quite publicly and noisily, so disgusted he was with the break of the tradition of hundreds of years.
So after owning the best of the West End for centuries, these old families are losing their grip on their residential property, house by house.
I don't think it's a shame that ancient families are losing their land. I don't tend to feel sorry for people who are very, very much richer than I am.
In only 5 miles, Dan and I have walked across £8.5 billion worth of real estate, owned by just 4 aristocratic families.
Dan!
So few acres worth so much. But what about the rest of the land in Britain? So far, we've accounted for a third of it, but there are 40 million acres to go. A surprising amount of land has been carved out to support the country's infrastructure. Public bodies like water, electricity and gas boards, industrial areas, and land owned by local authorities.
When you add 250,000 miles of roads, 21,000 miles of rail track, and the land that goes with them, infrastructure adds up to about 10% of Britain.
Whether it's privately or publicly owned, this is all land that's very much there for our benefit. Later we'll find out about 2 very large slices of land owned on our behalf by the state, the Ministry of Defence and the Forestry Commission. But first, Dan's been looking at a sizeable part of Britain most of us assume is very much our own, common land.
The thing about common land is it's actually one of those bits of Britain that we think we own, but we don't. There's about 1.5 million acres of common in Britain, and most of it is privately owned. It's called common land because in medieval times, the big landowners were forced by Parliament to let the common people who worked their land have a bit of the rough land around the edges to collect fuel and grow a bit of food on. It's what's left of that land that we know as commons today.
I've come to the Norfolk-Suffolk border to meet Richard Mabey, a nature writer who's made a study of common land.
So this is the Ling.
Yes.
So who would own this common?
Well, this common is owned, as most commons were, by the Lord of the Manor. It was part of his wasteland that he didn't want for other uses. The owner here has ceded the rights of management to a wildlife trust, and it's looked after partly as a nature reserve and partly as a public open space, and it's very popular with the people around here.
So this is Royden Fen.
This is Royden Fen.
And so this common land here was vital to the way of life of all the people that lived just around it.
It was vital to the kind of life that they traditionally lived. And down here what it gave you was reed for thatching houses, sedge for thatching as well. Peat was dug, you know, for use as fuel. Willows would have been cut for basketry. The river is about 100 metres to our left, and that would have been fish for eels. There was a huge range of stuff just for the ordinary fabric of subsistence in life.
But as land for agriculture became more valuable, landowners began eyeing up the wasteland the commoners had traditionally used. What followed was the biggest land grab in English history, the enclosures. Millions of acres were fenced into the big estates. What remained was remote and unproductive wasteland. The kind of wild landscape that makes up most of common land in England and Wales today. It must have been an absolutely enormous change for the people who had previously lived and worked these commons.
Well, we know that it was a time of immense trauma for them. Many fled to the cities to see if they could find work there. A lot emigrated. Some ended up in the workhouse because they weren't able to adjust to the discipline of a money economy. It severed their social relationships with each other. It severed their sense of territory. I mean, they didn't own the land, but they felt that they belonged to it rather than it belonged to them.
In the 100 years between 1750 and 1850, 7 million acres of common land were lost. What's left today is still being fought over. Norfolk is the scene of a modern-day battle between aristocrat and commoner. The dispute is over Hanworth Common. The people say the common is theirs, but a local aristocrat says it's been in his family for centuries, and he wants it back. Robert Harbord Hammond is the fourth son of Lord Suffield, whose family has been here since the 17th century. He claims the common belongs to him. He took the radical step of fencing it in.
We don't want it fenced in. We don't want it looking like Cowlitz. We have people bring horses across, and people walk on the common, wander about.
There has been no upset until some 6 months ago when Mr. Harbord Hammond breezed in saying that it was his land.
The Harbord Hammonds were once the biggest landowner in the county. But Robert's father sold the last substantial family holding, Gunton Hall, in the 1980s. Robert is trying to rebuild and look after what remains of his legacy, and he says he can prove it includes the common.
We've got the deeds from when we bought the land off the Duke of Norfolk, and then there's been various different deeds since then, and indeed the deed of transfer to me, which happened about 18 months ago now.
But the people of Hanworth say that they've run the common successfully for 100 years, and it's registered in their name.
Here we have a copy of the Commons Registration Act 1965, giving the ownership of the common to four trustees.
They have been responsible in running it for all those years, and they have left us with a legacy that we are actually going to fight and keep.
The villagers of Hanworth are taking Robert Harbord Hammond to court to try to prove that he doesn't own the common.
It is very expensive, so it has put a lot of pressure on a lot of people on the common, especially the two trustees who are basically putting everything they own into the fight. We are all, as villagers, doing our best to support them, and we have all promised and pledged finances to do it, but we are only a village of about 90 souls.
We need to get the estate back in order. In 100 years' time, the land will still be there, and what we spent on legal fees will be minuscule.
Can you think of a more idyllic position where you can look out of your window and see cattle grazing? So there is only really one reason to live in Hanworth, on Hanworth Common, and that is the common.
Somewhere in us, we believe that the open land is also our common heritage. And I think that determination to fight for the rights to our land is a thread that's run right through the last few centuries.
In the last few weeks, Robert Harbord Hammond has agreed to take the fence down, but both sides are still awaiting their day in court.
This isn't just a little local difficulty. In fact, there are moves afoot nationally to protect all the common land and open it up so we can roam all over it and use it as much as we want, no matter who it's owned by.
What could be nicer? A pretty English village and a pint of beer. A very unusual pint too, because this pub, the Red Lion at Chalgrove in Oxfordshire, isn't owned by a great big brewery chain, it's owned by the church. And it has been for the last 400 years.
There aren't many bits of holy ground in this country where you can buy a pint. In fact, the amount of holy ground has shrunk dramatically. Most parishes have lost much of their land and property.
The last time the church boosted its land holdings was in the Victorian era, and these spires and handsome rectories are very much the product of that time. The Industrial Revolution made Britain rich, and businessmen thanked God by donating land and money. The Church of England was loaded and landed. It owned 2 million acres of agricultural land and an extensive property portfolio in towns and cities. Reach out and touch faith.
Traditionally, the vicar or rector was never well paid, but his income was generally boosted by a plot of land called glebe, which came with the post.
But over the past 100 years, much of that glebe has disappeared. Yorkshire's a dramatic example of what's happened. The Yorkshire church here used to own 150,000 acres. But today, the dioceses of York, Leeds and Ripon, Bradford, Wakefield and Sheffield now own less than 5,000 acres between them. So 145,000 acres have gone. But where? The clergy have never been good at bookkeeping, so records are pretty vague.
In the past, we have lost land due to not particularly neglect, but historically, because it goes back not just hundreds of years, possibly thousands of years within the church, that land has passed down from vicar to vicar and payment or ownership has never been certified, basically. I would say that we have approximately about 2% of missing land out there somewhere. We would really like to know where that is.
Today there's a wedding at Thorne in the Diocese of Sheffield. This church once stood in extensive glebe land. Now all that's left is the car park. Yorkshire's not unique. The clue to how church land went missing can be found on a golf course in Buckinghamshire, where players can often be heard praying for a hole-in-one.
Straight down the middle.
I'm here to meet someone who witnessed the disappearance of church land, Canon Michael O'Connor of the Ecclesiastical Law Society.
Right, Michael. So, this particular bit of territory here was once glebe.
That's right. It used to belong to the Vicar of Bletchley. It was part of his glebe land. This was all a farm, and in the early 1970s, the district council approached him asking him to sell them land for this golf course and also for housing. And he sold them 162 acres for about 400,000, which I suppose in today's money is about £4 million.
4 million quid?
That's right.
That's right. A lot of money.
The money automatically would have been invested in London by the church commissioners, and he would automatically receive the income from that as part of his stipend.
Back in the 70s, this would have paid an income of £20,000, five times the salary or stipend of a vicar of the time. This reverend didn't do anything illegal, or for that matter, uncommon. Most of the missing church land was systematically sold off by vicars in this way. So it's no surprise that in 1978, control of land was taken out of the hands of vicars and given to their local dioceses.
Yes, it went straight down the middle. Today.
Right, well, let's hit a trail, shall we?
Whatever land the local dioceses have managed to hold on to is dwarfed by the 120,000 acres owned by the church commissioners. Church Commissioner Chairman Andreas Whittam Smith took me on a tour of their London property. They're at the sharp end, with £4.5 billion worth of land and property and investments. But like the other big institutions we've heard from, they know real money is in commercial and retail investment.
Are you buying or selling land at the moment?
We're sellers of land at the moment. Sometimes people have a sentimental attachment to an old piece of
property which was given to the church many hundreds of years ago, and perhaps they desist from selling it. That can happen. On the whole, we don't do that, actually. We're fairly hard-nosed.
Amazing to see the church owning these great solar blocks and commercial properties, isn't it? It just strikes one as odd.
I know, but remember that part of what we are is a pension fund, and most people's pension funds do own great big faceless blocks. So, you know, we're inevitably like the rest of the market.
So there we have it. The church now makes its money from a commercial world rather than a rural one. But thank God they haven't sold this pub off yet.
Nice to think I'm buying a pint in a good cause. A little bit of it may go towards repairs to the church tower. Cheers. So, once again, one of the big landowners of the past has now just a small share of the land in Britain. Like the Crown, the church has less than 1% of the land today.
The largest and most powerful players of previous centuries are now overshadowed by the biggest 21st century institution. The state owns more than 3 million acres.
What makes the state Britain's largest single landowner is the land the Forestry Commission and the Minister of Defence acquired when the country was at war.
The Forestry Commission was set up in 1919 to tackle the shortage of timber after World War I. The war effort had consumed so much timber that forest cover was down to its lowest ever, just 5% of the country.
Is that? I can't remember.
I'm here at Loch Katrin in Scotland with Forestry Commission Director General Tim Rawlinson.
So at that stage, you were all about growing trees as quick as you could, so that we could store them up and use them for wardrobes and ships and goodness knows what else.
Absolutely, and actually at that time, the country needed wood for pit props for the mines. Still have a very active coal mining industry. Conifers were planted, very fast-growing conifers, and we were set up to plant, create new forests.
What is the sort of balance between conifer and broadleaf over the country?
Well, on our estate, we've got about 10 to 15% of the total estate is broadleafed and the rest is coniferous.
So it's massively pine.
Yes, and spruce.
Now, to what extent are you trying to increase Forestry Commission land?
We're pretty much static in terms of the total area of forests that we manage. But we are moving into some areas, new areas. One of them is here at Loch Katrin, where we've taken on 25,000 acres to create new native woodlands. Really, as far as the eye can see, is the land that we've taken on. We'll be planting and regenerating the native species that grow around here. So, for example, oak and birch and rowan. We've actually got computer models showing what it'll look like in 20 years' time and 50 years' time and 100 years' time. But what you'll see is a mosaic, a very natural mosaic, of woodland and open spaces and the hilltops.
How would you describe the way the balance is shifting between you growing trees for timber, for cutting down and making wood, and providing leisure, providing a wonderful amenity for people?
Oh, I mean, in terms of our business, it's changed hugely. It might surprise you to learn that, aside from being the largest producer of wood in the country, we're the largest provider of countryside recreation in Britain. More people visit woodlands than visit the seaside each year.
When you think of this land, and you think of the ownership of this land, how does it feel to you? Who really owns the Forestry Commission's land?
Oh, it's absolutely clear in my mind. You know, this is national land. These are the nation's forests. We're the stewards of it, and we manage it on behalf of the nation.
Like the Forestry Commission, the other big state landowner, the Ministry of Defence, acquired its land in wartime. The MOD took over 20% of the UK during World War II, and it still owns 600,000 acres today.
Britain has always needed a variety of landscapes on which to train its army, navy, and air force. This was never truer than during the Second World War, when the nation was mobilised as never before, and farmers and landowners had to give up their acres to help the war effort.
the interests of property, the hours of labour, are nothing compared to the struggle for life and honour, for right and freedom, to which we have vowed ourselves.
Thousands had their land compulsorily purchased. At Pencnuc Farm near Aberporth on the Welsh coast, Meyer Davis's uncle, David Jones, lost 40 of his 55 acres in 1942.
Then my uncle received a letter from the Air Ministry, and it had a nasty word in it. Requisition of land. We hadn't a clue what that word meant, requisition. And on the 29th of September, the caterpillars moved in and knocked all the hedges down, and all the small fields were gone.
During the war, the land was used as a military airfield. Although the War Office returned most requisitioned land after the war, it held on to an extra 500,000 acres, including the village of Imber on Salisbury Plain and David Jones's farm.
He thought perhaps everything would come back to normal after the war, but it didn't, you see. Didn't. And that's it. I think he broke his heart, really.
The land was sold recently, but not to Mr. Jones's heirs. Instead, it was privatised, then sold on, partly to a private airfield and partly to the Welsh Development Agency. Because it's a public body, the agency needs take precedence over MOD rules, which say it should be offered back to the family first.
A lot of people made sacrifices during the war, and many people with their lives, but we also made a sacrifice in giving this land to the defence of this country. We've got a strong attachment to this land. This land was taken from us, and it should have been returned.
The sale was a tiny part of the biggest reorganisation of defence land for 60 years. Today, the MOD owns 600,000 acres of urban and rural land, 1% of Britain. But now, the MOD considers that it has too much land for its needs.
Since the end of the Second World War, things have changed dramatically as far as the armed forces are concerned. We have fewer people, and if we have fewer people, then we need a smaller estate for those people to live and to work on.
The MOD is slimming down. It's been given a target to get rid of millions of pounds worth of property, and it's currently looking into the usefulness of every port, base and airfield to see just how much land they can get rid of.
In just 5 years, Defence Estates has raised £1.4 billion for the Treasury, mostly by the sale of urban land, often for housing. But it's giving up very little land in the countryside.
We still need to retain a lot of rural estate for training our troops, particularly the army, because a lot of the new equipments that we've actually got at the moment and the ways that we need to train require a lot of space. So that means that we need to retain Senny Bridge, Otterburn, Salisbury Plain and so on.
In fact, in places the MOD is increasing its stake in the countryside. Yorwith Davis, who was born on what is now Senny Bridge firing range in Wales, has noticed the MOD buying up more land locally.
They have bought these farms out here. That's Kevin Coch, that's farm number 5, they call it. See? And then that's Gledra, that's farm number 8. They bought 4 farms in the latter years.
Despite buying up more of the countryside, the MOD actively encourages public access.
I think a lot of people might imagine because we own it, we don't allow people to go on it. Well, clearly we don't if we're firing across it, because that wouldn't be very sensible. But we do encourage access, and we have got 1,300 kilometres of paths and so on. If people do want to walk over our land, they can also see that we really do look after it, and they can see things they probably wouldn't see anywhere else, whether that's birds, wildlife, or flora and fauna that grow on the land.
fair play. They're working very well. They're doing a lot of conservation in all those fields there. They planted trees on them, and there's curlews back here. I hadn't seen or heard a curlew for 30 years, I don't expect. And the military have encouraged them to come back.
As well as training on its own land, the MOD also used the national parks. Here at the Brecon Beacons, the streams and mountains provide the ideal rugged terrain for training infantry and the SAS. In fact, they say the Falklands War was won in the Beacons.
Brothers in the woods! Come!
Most of Britain's national parks allow some military presence, from orienteering to flying jets. But for years, campaigners have been pressing the MOD to reduce their presence in the very sites they seem to have earmarked for expansion.
These are areas of top landscape quality, the areas of wild beauty, where people want to go for quiet recreation. We have a long-term policy for the military to leave these areas if they become core sites. Our understanding is that they have no intention of going whatever.
Clearly, there's a conflict of interest, but the MOD is staying put while promising to reduce the amount of land that's off limits to the rest of us. Both they and the Forestry Commission are aware that the 3 million acres they own are owned on our behalf.
So if you add together the Ministry of Defence and the Forestry Commission, these two big state bodies account for over 5% of land in the UK.
As we've heard, opening up the countryside for access is one of the great popular causes. In fact, it's just part of a trend which could eventually affect all of the countryside in Britain. It's a move away from using the land for agriculture to treating it as an environmental heritage. Soon, farmers will be paid subsidies not for the crops they produce and the cattle they farm, but for the land they own and manage. So the more you have, the more you get. Good news for the big farmers, not such good news for the small farmer, with a few acres of grain or a couple of hundred sheep.
At the moment, 250,000 small farmers own about 20% of the land in the UK. It's a big slice of the cake, but it may get smaller. By contrast, the biggest growth area has been the heritage and conservation organisations that are tax and donations support.
The National Trust was set up to rescue stately homes from decline when their aristocratic owners couldn't afford the upkeep. Often the owners stayed put in the manner to which they'd become accustomed, while the Trust picked up the tab. Now the Trust has more than 800,000 acres of land, over 1,000 miles of coastline, and 300 stately homes and castles. The other growing heritage groups are the wildlife organisations, such as the Woodland Trust and the Royal Society for the Protection of Birds.
OK, put all those heritage organisations together, and their slice of the cake is around 3%. It may look small, but it's the slice that's expanding fastest. So that leaves just one group of owners, a tiny number of people, but it looks like they're the biggest single section of all. Yes, we're back to the aristocrats and the traditional landed gentry, who 100 years ago owned half the country. Now we estimate they're still nearly a third. We can't be precise about this because so much land is unregistered, but it seems reports of their decline have been greatly exaggerated. It's long been fashionable for the aristocracy to claim that land is a poor investment.
What between the duties expected from one during one's lifetime and the duties exacted from one after one's death, land has ceased to be either a profit or a pleasure. It gives one position
and prevents one from keeping it up.
That's all that can be said about land.
Oscar Wilde's unforgettable Lady Bracknell was prophesying the downfall of the aristocratic landowners, weighed down by responsibility and high taxation.
Earlier, we saw how the aristocracy seemed to be losing their power, wealth and influence during a 20th century when death duties and super tax threatened the collapse of many an estate.
But in actual fact, their demise never came. Traditional landed gentry are just as much in evidence today in this country as they were a century ago, or even a millennium for that matter.
The great irony is that the same party that almost taxed them into oblivion then threw them a lifeline.
They were saved by the Labour government after the war because the new system of agricultural subsidies put them back in business. And so they were able to survive, large numbers of them, with very big land holdings.
When the current Earl of Lonsdale inherited in 1953, subsidies and a business training helped him revive farming and forestry on the remaining Lowther estate. Today, he's built it back up to 70,000 acres, survived the foot and mouth crisis, and leased thousands of acres of forest to Centre Parks. He says the inheritance tax bill his family will receive on his death is a fair trade-off for government help received.
I reckon somewhere between 3 million and 5 million is about what the Treasury take will be when I snuff it. And I think they deserve it. Because after all, the whole place might be worth 60 or 80 million quid, generated out of grants and tax reliefs. And I think it's high time that society had its chunk of it.
So, the Earl of Lonsdale expects to pay out somewhere less than 10% on his estate when he dies. Meanwhile, the Rutland family, among others, will be granted exemption on inheritance tax if they continue to share with the public landscapes and artworks that are considered of national cultural importance. For the Duke, it's a necessary evil.
In an ideal world like everyone, I think an Englishman's castle is his home and he'd like privacy. But I've long since accepted, and my father long since accepted, that that wasn't the case.
The agricultural subsidies the Duke of Northumberland receives are crucial to maintaining his role as a landowner.
I think in farming terms, it would be very difficult to make a profit, let alone break even, without farming subsidies. The farming subsidies actually help us to look after the environment, improve the conservation on the farms, and also employ people. And I think if you took that away, most farms would not be viable.
The Duke of Northumberland's forebears held on to their acres for nearly 1,000 years. It seems there's no danger the current Duke will be the man to lose them.
Do you think it is rather anomalous in the 21st century that you have all this property and so many other people have so little?
I don't know. I think it's a system that's evolved. It doesn't feel to me as if I'm sitting here owning huge tracts of land, because I obviously, you know, share it with hundreds of thousands of other people in one form or another.
Yes, but you're the owner.
I am the ultimate owner, I suppose.
So that's it then. In 21st century Britain, we have this hugely unequal distribution of land. And we accept it. The deal is we allow the aristocracy and gentry to own a bigger slice than any other single group, as long as they look after the land and allow us access to it. As for the rest, the church and the crown are surprisingly small slices compared to what they were historically, much bigger of the state and heritage organisations over there. Here is the vast majority of us, the homeowners. We're still on less than 10% of the land. But we're the ones keeping all of it alive, a going concern. Our tax rewards the state for looking after its acres, and our grants, donations and subsidies do the same for the heritage groups, the farmers and the private owners.
This journey's been quite a revelation for Dan and me. We may not directly own much of Britain, we certainly don't. But it turns out that because of all we pay for it, it is, in a real sense, our Britain anyway. We might as well enjoy it.
A tough emotional journey for Jeremy Paxman tomorrow. The new series of Who Do You Think You Are begins by the UK now on BBC Two to find out what makes Britain.